and good evening, like yesterday, because again we are going through the night, the dark night. To those who were here yesterday, I came here to present three lectures in which I use poetry or music or drama to learn with the artists what they know about the hidden dynamics of the soul. So yesterday, I took seven poems by our great Brazilian poet, Carlos Drummond de Andrade, because he had something to tell us or to teach us about things that you cannot observe clearly, what happens to the suffering soul, and how does it move to find relief from pain. And I also used two pieces by Chopin, who musically also expresses this precious but very difficult phenomenon to talk about, this transit between melancholy and sadness to openness to life. This second lecture has a different approach and a different topic. Now, I want again to use a piece of art that it's an operita or an operetta, in which there is a poem and music, to talk about the soul of a city. And the beginning of this story, obviously, is Jung, because Jung introduced the term in Latin, anima mundi, the soul of the world. And he was concerned with the suffering or the ailment or the illness the world's soul is suffering in modernity. And each one of us, as part of a whole, we also suffer because the collective soul is suffering. One and the whole are part of the same. And he wrote very important things about that. He used alchemy even to talk about the soul of the world. Now, originally I come from the social sciences, that means history, sociology, anthropology. And these extroverted sciences have a way to talk about the soul of the world, although anthropology and sociology don't use the word soul. This belongs to religion, and they don't like this expression. And then they would say the spirit of the time, or mentality, or culture, or modes of living. And of course, sociology, anthropology, and history talk about the changes in mentalities and culture, and there is a criticism of what modernity has done not to tradition, but to values that because of urbanization and the influence of the West and capitalism and globalization happens and how this affects local identities, ways of living, connections with the past, and so on. This is the extroverted approach by the social sciences. Now, Jungian psychology has an introverted approach, so it looks to the inside and to very intangible things. I am very interested in this topic, and I have chosen a work of art called Maria de Buenos Aires, and I'll make a little introduction so that you can follow me. Artists, not all of them, but the real artists, they have an antenna or a sonar, as we saw in the workshop yesterday. Artists have an antenna that they catch things that, like FM, AM doesn't catch that, but an artist will catch very subtle waves in which contents or reality flow, but they are not easily contacted, or they have like a an artisan well, an artist can touch a very deep layer, like the water, how do you call that, lençol freático, you know, the deep layer of water, like a deep well, and they bring water from the depths, or they bring something very high up in the sky. This is what real art does. So we, as Jungians, we are not inflated to the point that we believe we can interpret art and teach to the artist what he really wanted to say. This exists in the literature, but this is not what Jung did, and this is not we, as his followers, want to do. We want to learn with the artists and try to bring out or to extract from a work of art a wisdom about realities that we do not contact easily in our normal range of consciousness. Okay. I will be talking about a Latin American work of art, and I want to remind to you that the three Americas, North, Central, and South America, have a very ancient soul, very ancient, by the millions of people who inhabited the Americas before Columbus arrived in 1492 and the New World was discovered. Discovered. It has always been there, but then it was discovered. And especially Spain and Portugal, but also France and Holland and England, they took possession of this land as if it belonged to nobody. And the inhabitants were half humans because they were not Christians. This, I think, all of you know. And you know about the pre-Columbian high cultures that existed in the Americas, from Alaska and the Labrador Peninsula to all the Indian in the plains of North America and Canada, to the Yucatan Peninsula and the Aztec and Maya and the previous civilizations, or in the Andes, the Inca Empire, and all the other cultures that came before that, and all over Brazil. Brazil had about 10 million indigenous people when the Portuguese arrived there. So there is an ancient soul, there is a pre-Columbian soul, but there is a prehistoric soul. Archaeology now is having a revolution in what concerns the population of the Americas. And there have been recent findings in Chile proving the presence of Homo sapiens in Chile 35,000 years before the present. And in the north of Brazil, fire stones have been found in archaeological sites with 49,000 years of age. In 2 years, I think I will come back here to talk about rock paintings in the Americas, and then we will see the images of the soul that stone has kept for us. But this changes the Eurocentric point of view, because it seems that culture and everything else originated in Europe, but this is not true. Actually, Europe, or the West, has almost destroyed the ancient soul of the Americas. And all the American countries, all of them, have been colonized. And you know that colonization implies a psychology with it. We colonized people, we all had to work out an inferiority complex. Because to be colonized means you have to mirror, your mirror is the metropolis, is the colonizer. And And then there is this imitation tendency to evolve by reproducing the models of the metropolis. And this you see in architecture, this you see in education, this you see in modes of living. And this is our problem. This is what we have to work culturally, politically, psychologically in our analysis, because all of us carry this historical complex in us. But from the 19th century on, big cities appeared in all the Americas. Think of New York and Chicago, think of Mexico City, think of São Paulo, Buenos Aires, or Montevideo, or Lima. These cities grew with a mixture of indigenous inhabitants, African that were introduced from Africa as slaves by the millions, and European immigrants. Today, the largest city in the world is Tokyo. The metropolitan area of Tokyo has 27 million people. And in the second place, we have three cities: Mumbai, or Bombay in India, Mexico City, and São Paulo, where I and others here live. Around 20 million people. So, Mexico City, São Paulo, Buenos Aires, they are metropolitan, enormous cities, multicultural, part European, part American, and part Latin American. And a new soul was created in these human centers, a mixed soul, as I said, with three roots: indigenous, African, European. This mixture, by the end of the 19th century, had acquired a cultural form. That means a lifestyle, a style of urban life, a mixed architectural style, and culture that had European roots, but also African and indigenous roots. So, the real contemporary soul of Latin American cities had an identity at the turn of last century, but with industrialization, globalization, the destruction of rural life, this soul increasingly was defaced. Sociology studies it, anthropology studies that, and we, Jungians, do and should study more. What has happened? I cannot say what has happened to the soul of Switzerland, but my Swiss friends also lament that many values or components of the Swiss soul are lost. I don't know about Austria or Germany or England. I'm not in doubt to talk about that, but I think it deserves that somebody makes an analysis. What is happening in Zurich? I came here in 1978. Yesterday I was downtown and I said, where is that fantastic toy store Weber? It's gone. Where is Pezzalozzi, where I used to buy toys for my children who were born here? I mean, it's not only shops. Zurich also is becoming what would you say, globalized or too modern. And I don't want to be nostalgic, but if you have a criterion, you would say something is being lost. Okay. In Latin America, there is no doubt. By the way, please raise hands those who come from Latin America. am from Argentina, and we have three Marias from Argentina. Okay. Why have I am a Brazilian? I am very how you say, atrevido, bold, because I'm not talking about my own country, I'm talking about the neighbor. First of all, I love my Spanish-speaking neighbors. I've been to Buenos Aires and Montevideo, and I have studied, and I have a good appreciation. But as I said yesterday, if you work with art, try to go back to something that moved you when you were a child or when you were an adolescent, where you were young. And Maria de Buenos Aires moved me in 1968, when I was 24 years old. And it's still in my ear, the voice of the singer and the music by Piazzolla, who is a musician who revolutionized the tango, because the tango was becoming too commercial. And then he came and he made a revolution in tango. He created a modern tango, and he's the author of the music. The poet is from Uruguay, but Montevideo and Buenos Aires are on opposite banks of the River Plate. So there is a cultural complex. You can say there is a soul. When you come with airplane and you look and you say there is a soul here in all this area. And why did I choose an Argentinian piece? Because I don't know of any other, either in Brazil or Chile or Peru or Mexico, that captures and figures as a woman, because it's a feminine principle here. What happened to the root soul of a city? As I said, a sociologist can analyze that, an anthropologist can. But we will look how artists do. And the terms and the images, which even psychology cannot say that. So I propose that we learn. And the story, I will shortly begin, it's like a story, so that you understand. The thread of the story is that a poet who is nostalgic of the old soul that was expressed in tango music, because that was the soul of these poor people, the Pampa Indians, the blacks, and the immigrants in the port of Buenos Aires, when they gathered, they made music. Their soul, their feelings, their lyrics was there. And with time, that changed, that was lost. So the poet, he is nostalgic. And what does a nostalgic poet do? He takes to drink. So he goes to a bar and he starts to drink. And then he gets very poetic and very, he is really drunk. So he's in a bar. And then he remembers this woman called Maria de Buenos Aires. And then, as if he were a shaman, he invokes her specter. Specter? He invokes, the word is specter, because she's dead now. So he invokes her, as in a black ritual, that she might come back. And this is the beginning of the story, the invocation of the lost soul of Buenos Aires. And she will respond, but she will not appear as a body. She appears as a voice. So in the beginning, you hear her voice with no words. And in the sequence, men, only men, will remember her story, and they will tell the story. Now, tango, which was very male-oriented, men said things about women from the masculine point of view. And here, Maria will tell her story. So this is also a change. It's not from the male, the masculine point of view. It's from her point of view. And she will tell a very strange story, which we will follow. And the last comment is, Maria de Buenos Aires is a Christmas drama. You know, in Catholicism, you have the enactment of the birth of Jesus. This is represented by children in churches, in, you know, the nativity scenes, and all the sacred music, Catholic Christian music from Bach or from medieval times. Many times this topic of the birth of the boy Jesus is retold, and we have fantastic medieval or baroque music about this topic. Think of Handel's Messiah, for instance. Okay, this is a parallel to that, but to the reverse. You know, it's the other side of the story. So here is not the Virgin Mary. It's another Mary. It's a Mary of the streets. And this is a parallel that the poet will make, because there will be a birth at the end of the story. Now, briefly, this is an international school. I see some students here who come from the East. Many are from Europe or from North America. So let me be humorous here. This is a joke. We are in Küsnacht here, you see? Can you find Küsnacht? So Küsnacht is here. This is our dear friend Google. And there we go. Let yourself be transported to the River Plate, to Buenos Aires, and to the Riachuelo, is near the port. This is the destination of immigrants from Spain, Italy, Poland, Switzerland, Germany, France, England, and many others. And that's where our story will take place. Now, as you know, in 1942, Columbus discovered the Americas. In 1516, the River Plate was found, and they believed they would find gold, not silver. But there was no gold there. It was the El Dorado, all these myths and fantasies. In 1536, this is the origin of Buenos Aires. It was called Santa Maria de Buenos Aires. It was a small settlement surrounded by Indians. And this is to show you briefly how Buenos Aires grew in the 19th century. In 1580, there is the official foundation of the city. In 1776, there is a vice-royalty of the River Plate uniting Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, and southern Bolivia. In 1810, the population was 44,000. In 1816, Argentina is the first Latin country to declare its independence from Spain. Brazil was in 22. This is just an image of the Pampa Indians that lived in that area before the Spaniards arrived. This is the oldest photo of the Cabildo, which is the government house in Buenos Aires. 1855, 90,000. With the Industrial Revolution, England had a very strong trade with Argentina, so there were railroads already in the middle 19th century. Here you see the poor immigrants, women washing clothes, washing laundry in the river. These are German immigrants, 1870, population 230,000. You see immigrants, but they want to be well-dressed because they are European, right? So they come and they try to find a place for themselves there. This is already a factory, Alpargatas, 1890. And by this time, Argentina is the major exporter of wool, wheat, and beef. And there is a rapid economic growth and a very strong immigration policy. This is a main street in end of 19th century. You see the population, and this looks like Paris, for instance. This is the port. I don't know what to do with this sound. These numbers. Do I need a microphone?
No,
the voice is good.
To register? No? Oh, it's much better. So you see, here is to see the proportion of Italians, for instance. In 1887, 60% of the population were Italians. By this time, my four grandparents migrated to Brazil, and São Paulo has a composition similar to Buenos Aires. The Spanish group in 1914 was 38% of the population. And then you have a French, smaller group, English, German, and Polish, and others too. So this creates the new society with all these influences. And this society creates a soul. Creates a soul at the end, not creates, gives it a cultural form at the end of 19th century. And here you have Polish immigrants in Buenos Aires, and you know the term Polaka. Polish women were imported because there were more men than women. And so prostitutes were imported from Poland and from France to work for these single immigrant European men. And by the way, the brothel was the place where tango originated, in the street and in the brothel. And this is where men would go to feel emotions. It was not only sex. It was a sense of belonging to a new social group. So this popular culture, as all popular cultures, is rooted in poorness, in people, hard-working people. They created the basic culture of our Latin American cities. The culture they created with time was taken over by the elite. So the tango will be taken over by the elegant elite of Buenos Aires who went to Paris. And then a couple would dance the tango in Paris and everybody would think this is fantastic, and then it becomes elegant. But before, an educated woman or even a rich man would never dance that. They would dance the Austrian waltz in their parties, in their salons. But around the 30s, you see how the upper class steals from the underdog, something that in the beginning is devalued, but then it becomes chic. But then, with time, it loses its real nature. And this is the drama of our story. How social inequality and hierarchical societies, what happens with root
culture where the soul is legitimately there. With time, it becomes more refined, it acquires form, but it loses its heart. This is our problem. This is an old photo of the port. This is rare. It's a gathering of Swiss ladies in 1900. Look how they are dressed, showing that they have a very clear identity. They don't have to acquire a new identity because they bring their own, which is there in their... this is each canton has a different dress, and there they exhibit it. This is a hostel, it's an immigrant's house. When immigrants arrived at the port, this would be the first place they would live before they would find jobs. Spanish immigrants. This is a dormitory. Gypsies. Population. You see there how it grows fast. There is international trade, industrialization. And Buenos Aires was the fastest growing, and soon Buenos Aires had more telephones than Paris when telephone was adopted, for instance. It had taxis. It was extremely elegant. If you go to a Marché Opus, how you say that in English? To a second antique market, if you go in San Telmo, you would find very refined china and things of olden times, because Buenos Aires was like Paris or London. I mean, the furniture, the silverware, the hats and canes and things, it was a very rich and Europeanized city. This is an elegant cafe in this shop, Gatton Chavez, 1910. You see how the city, so quickly, it looks like a European city. Now we jump to the war. In the beginning, Brazil and Argentina, they were siding with fascism. But around 43, when there was a turn, in the beginning of the turn between the Allies and the Axis, both Brazil and Argentina then changed position and aligned with Allies and broke with Rome, Germany, Berlin, and Tokyo. But this is, historians show you how in Argentina many Nazis found refuge, and even how Pius XII was ambivalent, and how Perón and Vargas in Brazil, they were ambivalent. Were they siding with Germany or with England and the United States? And here I will skip, because after the war comes Perón, and that's the big populist phenomenon and populism, which is destroying Venezuela, for instance. Populism is a poison because it brings a fake culture, a fake identity, but people want a father, they want a leader, and they want an ideology, and then look what's happening in Venezuela. And in Brazil we have a crisis, in Argentina there is a crisis today, and this kind of politics began after the war. And I don't have time today, because there is a very important feminine figure in Argentina, which is Evita Perón. She's famous now, she has become a pop star because of the musical. But Evita was a phenomenon. Nowhere else in the world was there a woman with her stamina and her energy. And she tried to embody the feeling, the popular feeling. So, in the first Union Congress in Latin America, which was in Uruguay, Punta del Este, I made a presentation in which I considered Evita Perón as an anima figure. But today I changed my mind. Maria de Buenos Aires is the anima figure. Evita Perón is a populist, but we can be mistaken because ideology interferes in our cognition. So we are deluded many times when we try to understand, even we Jungians, because politicians are tricky and they deceive you. And this woman had an enormous charisma, but she is not what Maria de Buenos Aires is. If I'm wrong, you correct
me. No, I fully agree.
I even have a speech by Evita Perón, but we don't have the time. It's very moving. No, no, no. Don't have time.
No, no. No.
Okay, tango. I've said something already. Tango began in the mid-19th century. There is the influence of the habanera. It's a musical form from Havana, Cuba. Milonga, which is a dance form prior to tango, and there is an influence of African percussion rhythms and European music. Altogether, this is an alchemical mixture, and you have this typically Argentinian sound and lyric, because it's always with lyrics. As it's said here, initially it was only available in local dances. Soon it becomes popular, and then tango permeated the life in Argentina. This is a very old, perhaps the first photo of a bandoneon, this harmonica here, that originally came from Germany. But in Argentina, the bandoneon has a very special sound that really transmits something of feeling, this specific instrument, which we will hear a lot. So you see, it was a popular dance. Men used to rehearse amongst themselves before they would dance with women. So this is very interesting. They are all machos, but they would dance. This is photo, it's 1904. They are rehearsing tango, or here, in the market in Buenos Aires, these macho men dancing together to be able to enchant the ladies. This is a street group playing in Mataderos. There you see the bandoneon, men dancing again. There is a typical formation of instruments in the origin of tango. And when the upper class took it over, these, dance clubs, or Armenonville, Rose Pavilion, Chanteclair, they were very elegant, and then only the upper class would go there, and tango becomes element. And there you have this romantic figure of the man and the woman, and then there is a whole myth about tango. This is the automobile club. And when gramophone records began to be sold, of course, tangos were recorded and everybody would buy a record. This is Carlos Gardel in film.
También.
This is a film. This is a shop store, and this is the most famous of all, La Compasita, 1916. Mercedes Simone, this is a woman, which is not so common. Mercedes Simone. Tita Marello. Libertà Lamarca. Di Secolo. And this is Piazzolla, 1969, Ballada para un Loco and Maria de Buenos Aires. I was 18 and it warmed my heart. No, this is Ballada para un Loco. We don't have time for that. Now his records became famous. Adios Nonino is a loved tango. Well known, 1960, 1964, and now this is the bandoneon, and now we go to Maria de Buenos Aires. Will you follow me? I have made subtitles in English. It's a working translation. I could not translate the whole lyric because it's too surrealistic. It would be very difficult. Would need explanation, and it's not pure Spanish. It has the local dialect, which is called lunfardo. I can speak Spanish, but I don't understand lunfardo, as you don't understand a dialect in London, or what is it called?
It's a, like a Cockney.
Yeah, like Cockney, because it has Italian words and. So it was very difficult. I needed many dictionaries to translate because tango uses this dialect of the low quarters. Okay. So it opened in Buenos Aires in 68. The score is by Astor Piazzolla. It's an operetta in two acts, and the lyrics by the Uruguayan poet Horacio Ferrer. And we will hear Amelita Baltar, who became very famous. And you will see she has a smoky voice. She is interpreting Maria. Yeah. This is the presentation. Introduction. But what I want to do is to discover how music transmits this without words. So it depends on the way you listen. And I will do the overture of Maria de Buenos Aires without images, although I have told you this introduction, and try to listen to the several themes and see what they do to you. Music is abstract, but it conveys something. So we will hear the overture, only the music without images, and then I will repeat it with images of Buenos Aires from an old archive of the 30s, and then you will see that this music was born there. But before, let's stay with the abstraction of music, trying to catch which chords this music touches in each one of us, whatever background we have. Because music is universal language. So this is the overture. Midnight in Buenos Aires. The spirit in the poet evokes the image of Maria and conjures up her voice.
Ahora que es la hora y que un rumor de yerba mora trasnocha en tu silencio, por un poro de este asfalto yo habré de conjurar tu voz. Ahora que es la hora. Ahora que ya has muerto para siempre y van de asalto por vos mis brujas rubias a tanguear misas calientes al alba con sus lerdas putanías de contralto. Ahora que tu amor se fue a barata y zurdamente con una extraña arcada para esta entrada postera, te ardió una cruz de vino en la tiniebla de la frente. Ahora que en la sórdida tensión filustera de un clave bien trampeado tocan tanto huesos, las manos desveladas de un caín y una trotea. Ahora que el rencor, con rabia y pólvora de un beso, gatilla en su plegado bandoneón, la hechicera de un golpe en ay menor para el costado de tus besos. Ahora que ya estás de nunca más, niña María, yo mezclaré un puñado de esa voz bandoneonera que aún quema en tu garganta con un poco de la mía, con borra de recuerdos, fiato negro y carraspera tordilla de un bordón. Así, del íntimo extramuro porteño de tu adiós, atravesando las fronteras sencillas de la muerte, he de traer tu canto oscuro. Tendrá la edad de Dios y dos antiguas mataduras, un odio a diestra y a zurda una ternura. Y al duro y dulce son fantasma de sus ecos, las futuras Marías, repechando Santa Fe junto a otra aurora, se apurarán temblando sin saber por qué se apuran. Ahora que es la hora, humo saibro y yerba mora, penacho de relente, ya tu voz, María Mente, vendrá con tu memoria aquí, pequeña y pura. Ahora que es tu hora, María de Buenos Aires.
Ahora que es tu hora, now that your time has come, midnight. The hour of the Virgin Mary is 6 p.m. The hour of Maria is midnight. And the drunken poet, he evokes her through a pore in the asphalt. So she's underground. She's covered by asphalt. You see the image? The city. It's covered up So she's below, and he's calling her through a little hole in the asphalt, and he evokes her as with a hangover, with a coarse voice. And he says, now we play tango with your bones. Look at the imagery. Now she's like a phantom, like a skeleton. And he wants her to cross the frontiers of death. And he says, she has a polarity. On the right, hatred, and on the left, tenderness. So you see how it's the first way of addressing this gone woman or gone soul, and how he's worried with the girls who cross the streets of Buenos Aires, not knowing where they're going. And you see these old photos of people here and there, and you look at this photos of the 30s by great photographers that luckily my assistant found. And you have this feeling, do these people know where they belong? Do they know what they are doing? Because this is the absence. Something is missing. And then we don't know. And now the poet wants to do something about it. And Maria responds to the call. And she appears incarnated in her voice, chanting a tango theme without words, because the tango is her language. Can you make contact with that? We saw the environment of the soul and how she sang. And there is something in this musicality, in the sound, there is already something. And it's as if she said, okay, you called me, here I am. And this is what she has to say. And we start to see where she came from the poor quarters of the periphery, Arrabal, the poor neighborhoods of Buenos Aires, which was full of life. And if you go there, you still see some remnants of those quarter of those houses. So she has manifested, and now the street singer, the poet, who has a duende, the poet has a spirit in him, and other popular types, all men, they will describe how they remember her. And then the story is the bandoneon will try to attract Maria with his music. We must remember she came from beyond the town, in a place where there are no pathways, where there is mass in the church, doves in the street, horny boys, a train, a whore, a corner shop. This is the vaults, Viennese vaults, trying to attract, you see? It's a conventillo.
Pianito de mala raya, que muere cuentos, a ver si muestra el rencor en la hilacha, desmanse a la muchacha, la que nadie quiere ver.
Ella vino desde aquella dimensión
transpatriotera,
donde alcanza a la esperanza una barrera y un camino, algunos mozos que le den a las poseras y un andén con otro humo y otra pena y otro tren para la espera, una novena, una ramera, un almamén.
La pequeña nació un día que estaba borracho de Dios, por eso en su voz dolía, tres clavos zurdos nacía con un insulto en la voz.
De arena en el río del cielo los días tan duros y a espaldas del río, allá donde el río se junta a la nada, la niña María creció en 7 días.
La sabana de la muerte punteaba en su soledad,
como esta ciudad de duelo,
grieving and party.
Diosa y atorante, del cielo y del ámbar de trampa lo mismo, y atados de un pelo por el alba afán, su parte de abismo, su parte de pan.
It's the contrary of the Virgin Mary. Ave Maria in reverse. You see how the poet describes the soul. It's no rosy pinky thing. He says she was born when God was drunk, and that she's a mixture of abyss and bread. Now this is tough matter. I think here we are talking about the soul. Yeah, three nails in her voice, and she has an insult in her voice. See, there is a very elegant way of talking about the soul, but I think this is the way to talk about it, without embellishment. It's not something simply nice, and it can be revengeful. And her story is very tough. Once her image is conjured up, we will hear Maria's story. Now, a man who desired her says she was magnetized by forces that kept her away from him. So a man wanted to have soul. But soul had its own, was under influences above the human realm. So he could not have her a contact with the soul, and then he curses it, saying she would hear forever his voice in the voice of every man. You see, this is a mixture here of the human and the archetypal. As a man could not have access to the archetype, he curses the archetype. But here you have already a dissociation. It was a difficulty to integrate the soul at the origin. And then the thing went wrong. Historically, culturally, collectively, and individually. But it's different to simply say the anima. You see, I think this is deeper, it's wider. Mm-hmm. Because if you say anima, it doesn't apply to women. we are talking about the collectivity. And then there was a cut, there was a separation. And you can talk what happens to those who are deprived of a contact with that realm. But then we learn only through art what happens to the soul. Because it might be an imagination, it might be a fiction, or it is real. But it's very difficult to talk about that. I will not have time, unfortunately, to go through, because when I'm talking, I want to share with you and explain things, but I must come to the end, so we'll have to skip some parts. What will happen is that Maria dies, the story of her death will be told. But even dead, she walks in the streets of Buenos Aires in the night. She's a specter. And as a specter, bodiless, she is a virgin. And the story unfolds that then the poet, drinking more and more and more, he calls his friends and he says, Maria must conceive. She must become a mother. And she must generate another soul. And then the question is, who will fertilize Maria? Because she will get pregnant, like the Virgin Mary, who was fertilized by the Holy Spirit, by God, through a man called Joseph, but actually Jesus is the Son of God. So, what does the poet do? Maria will be fertilized by poetry. It's not the man poet, it's his lyricism that will touch the soul. What do we have here? The way to reconnect with the soul is through sensibility, is through poetry, is through art, is through fantasy and imagination. This makes the Virgin Mary or Maria pregnant. I cannot share with you all the steps of the story because of time. Can I advance a little bit? Do you know how this works here?
It's lunchtime. And you have at least 15 minutes more.
Because you see, I want to work with poetry and with music, right? Now it's clear. It is poetry that fertilizes the soul. But music represents this, and this is the utmost value. If we connect with what music teaches us. And here, the main sound is that of the bandoneon. Bandoneon has a breathing, right? It has air in it, so it has pneuma. And it's almost like a human voice. So, as that man cursed her in her story, she leaves her neighborhood at night and she wanders about Buenos Aires silently and in a trance. Just for you to have a taste, the violin, this is Maria wandering in the night. The obelisk. Bandoneon. music conveyed something, right? Possessed by the sound of the bandoneon, as in the old legends of tango, she sings now her conversion to the life of shadows. So the Virgin Mary never went to the shadows, because Maria does. She converts not to her shadow, but to the shadowy life, to the shadow of life. Because she cannot manifest in life any longer. So when the soul is absent, it's in the shadow of life, not in my shadow. It cannot come to light. So she's threatened by the sun, not like a vampire, but because she cannot live under the sun. She cannot manifest in life. This is what the poet says. Trotting towards nothingness. That's what she says about herself. Caught by the very story he has been telling, the spirit poet seeks the bandoneon and engages in a duel with it. But this is only, I have to skip this. I only let you hear a little taste. Said the bandoneon was her voice, right? That's Piazzolla. Maria descends to the sewers. There, the thief, who's a character there, condemns her shadow to return to the other hell, that of the city and of life, and to wander forever, chased by sunlight. In front of her body, it is revealed that her heart has died. So in the beginning, she's in the underground, in the sewers. But then the thief, who reigns there, sends her to the other hell. The other hell is the city, at night. And then they say, her heart has died. She's a spectre. This is sewage. That's where the soul ends up. Jesus carried all the sins of the world. Maria carried all the pain of the world. This is the parallel. The duende means the spirit of the poet, reports the funeral performed by the creatures of the night for the first death of Mary. This is the death of Maria when she was incarnated.
Maria de Buenos Aires murió por primera vez. La enterraron, ya era tarde, con sus buenas funerales, un puñal y un cascabel. Se murió tanto la niña cuando no se pasó a morir, pero una trágica encina que se dio de muertecitas no se estaba de marido.
After Maria's body is buried, the Via Crucis of Maria's shadow starts, who will wander around, lost in the night in Buenos Aires. Not knowing with whom she could share her despair, Maria's shadow sent a letter to the trees and chimneys of her neighborhood. But I have to has the second largest gathering of psychoanalysts after London. And they migrated to Brazil, many of them. And then the poet makes a joke that the analysts want to analyze Maria and they want to recover a memory. And she has, but I have no memory. But they want to extract a dream from Maria to analyze her. And the poet portrays the analysts as such, a circus.
Passe a ver, caballero, cosas jamás nunca vistas. Traeremos los analistas a este tiempo por tener.
Buenos Aires, Buenos Aires,
Buenos Aires, salgan los sueños al sol. Que este sueño es de María, Rataplín y Rataplón.
But she has no dream.
Cámara uno, al recuerdo. Cámara dos, al consciente.
Consciousness.
Difícilmente. Los brazos han cortado en cuatro que estaba diciendo. Se pelearon las cuatro troneras de un guitarro malo. Y ahora llevo pues lo compré a un corazón. Dijo que esto era lo que convenía para ti, como yo soy una sombra, María. Y yo por sombra, solo sombra, seré sombra y seré libre para siempre.
She says she has no dream, she has a heart that was cut in four. Having lost her track, the poet starts to call her leaning in the counter of a surreal bar. Now he's completely drunk. He sends her a message urging her to find out the mystery of conception. This is the bar, the piano bar, American bar, full of masks.
Lo cuentan de escolazo, las sotas y las presas, ventrílocos cabreros de cosas que el destino fermenta entre los mazos. Aquí, colgado al ñato al revés de cada vaso, nos mira el ojo quieto y abierto de locura. Y algún disepolín que quiso darle los pasos al diablo, cosió con un hilito de amargura.
He doesn't know if he's going mad or it is the devil.
Un tu día nacerá del meridiano cachuzo de umbral en donde ordena su misa algún poeta a contramano. Así sea, María, de cristiano, así de tuyo y nuestro. Que así sea.
Amén. Amén. So this is the Virgin Mary. Maria. Evita però. This is by Tomás Eloy Martínez, The Argentine Dream. Where is Argentina? At the end of the world, center of the atlas, ceiling of the universe. Argentina's a power or powerlessness, a destination or a blunder, the neck of the third world or the tail of the first. Is there a place for Argentina, a shore, a little corner where to accommodate without being moved by the mood of its rulers and the imagination of its legislators? Or Argentina is nowhere, and then Argentines belong to nothing. We are the only legitimate children of utopia. This applies to all Latin Americans. The poet's troupe go out to the streets in search of a germ of a song of a son for Maria. And they rush. Maria receives, no, Maria. Yeah, she receives the revelation of her fertility. So this is the angel, see? This is the ovary. Sunday morning, Christmas Day. In the 30th floor of a building in construction, Maria's shadow, redeemed by pain and virgin forever. The soul is virgin forever because the soul can always be fertilized and generate and remains virgin. This is the myth of the virgin birth. The soul, even in the shadows, is virgin, gives birth not to a Jesus Christ, but to another Maria girl. Is it the resurrection of her shadow, or is it another Maria? Is everything over, or beginning anew? Neither the poet spirit nor anybody on earth can answer this question. Because we never know if we have reached the soul.
Guarda, Maria, che nasce il
terminaste haciendo tanto que te pare hasta el olvido y te empuja entre las manos de una raíz de una rabia y terminaste apelaste por las puntas de otras trenzas, por las grietas de los labios, por el gesto y por las ganas de hacerte hasta el cansancio. ¿Cuánta Navidad tenías atragantada en los años? ¡Qué safra brava! María, safra de parto, tu parto.
A quien recién ha nacido nada le sobra y no tiene cuna.
Su padre, que es carpintero de obra, ha de hacerle una.
Thank you.